In the heart of the night, this world were bright, we will set it alight. In the heart of the night, in the heart of the night, this world were bright, we will set it alight. In the heart of the night.
Everyone, I am Anthropomantic Fiends, and I do horror-related things on the internet. Last week, I reviewed, regrettably, Bigfoot Blood Trap, which I can never unsee. Thank you, Evil Stevel. But today, I've moved on from that, and I have started on the movies from the Big Box of Horror. By that, I mean half of the Big Box of Horror, because the front of it says 9 movies. There are 5 movies in there, and I think I bought what was originally half of, like, the two cases taped together thing that Echo Bridge likes to do. So this isn't actually the whole Big Box of Horror, but it had some stuff in it that intrigued me, and one of my good friends actually owned the Big Box of Horror and was like, hey, this movie you reviewed is actually in the box set, so I ended up picking it up. I've been waiting for months and months to finally get to these movies and review them, and we are starting with this one. This is Hurt. This movie came out in 2009. It is directed by Barbara Stepanski, who also co-wrote the script. I have not written down any of the other cast or crew members by name, but they all did a fantastic job, so I recommend looking all of them up and seeing what other stuff they've done. This movie revolves around a family called the Coltranes. The mother has some issues from her past. Her husband died in a horrible car accident. She moves with her kids out to her uncle's decrepit old house in the middle of the desert and in the middle of his junkyard, which is currently occupied by wolves that he cannot get rid of no matter how hard he tries. The mom, in order to honor her late husband's wishes, takes in a little girl from this boarding school who has some issues herself. Her mom and her dad both died in a horrible car accident. She is taken in by the family, and they all live off of the little they have in this decrepit old house. They have to deal with the hardship of that situation. Distrust starts to grow between the family members, and tensions arise, and there seems to be something more going on to cause this conflict than what's on the surface. The soundtrack for this movie is pretty. It's not anything too remarkable. It's a solid modern film score. It's very sort of ethereal and ambient, lots of keys and strings and all of that good stuff. No real definable themes that come to mind in my head. And the only other music in the film is whatever's on the car radio. Not really a super memorable, definitive score or anything, but it serves its purpose in the film, and it sounds nice. Same with the cinematography, I suppose. It's serviceable, and it looks really nice. The lighting in the movie is really beautiful. In the more shadowy areas in the film, it serves to heighten some of the creepier moments. The landscapes that they pass by are very pretty. The sets besides the old house are just kind of normal people's houses, and the costumes are just kind of people's clothes. There's not really anything wowing going on there. The one thing I will say about the costumes is the mom was very crafty in the past, and she liked to make jewelry, and there's this necklace that she has that she ends up giving to Sarah, the little girl that she's taken in, and it is a tool that the filmmakers used to kind of show some of the character dynamics between them and what they do with the necklace. It works for the story, and it's a nice looking necklace too. And the junkyard plus uncle's old house as a setting makes for this awesome atmosphere. It feels really unsafe. Everything is rusty and sharp and metallic, and everything just looks like you can cut yourself on it, which you kind of can. It's falling apart, it's decrepit, it's really, really sharp looking. It's this very, very unfriendly atmosphere for all of these people to be in, which serves as this extension of the stuff that's going on with the characters, and it's just very physically uncomfortable to look at, but also really beautiful in this sort of antique way. One of my favorite lines in the movie is when the daughter in the family, who is named Lenore, by the way, which I think is amazing, and her brother are just sitting up on this, I don't know what you call it, but this area that's sort of overlooking the whole junkyard. She's talking about how her life has just gone completely downhill since the dad died, and she's just going, now that all this horrible stuff has happened, I can see clearly now. She looks away from the brother and out towards the junkyard, and she goes, this is what life is actually like. And it cuts to just this huge pile of cars and car parts and scrap metal and just this desert of desolation. And it's kind of awesome, but also really depressing, but that's why it's awesome. I will get into setting more later, but there are very specific elements of that particular setting that serve parts of the story. I'll get to that more in a later part of the review when I talk more about the story itself, but the setting itself has little set pieces and elements that really don't just serve as like symbols, but they really serve to move the story along, and I thought it worked really well. The first character I really connected with in the movie is a duckling named Jefferson that Lenore keeps as a pet, and I just felt really bad for him, because first thing we see is him in this cage, and Lenore going, it's gonna be all right, Jefferson, and then I think her brother just walks in and kind of grabs the cage from her and puts Jefferson in the trunk with a bunch of other boxes on top of him, and at that moment I was kind of like, I don't care what they're up against in this movie. From now on, you who did this to Jefferson, you are the monster in my eyes. That changed as I really got into the nuances of the film, but I just felt so bad for Jefferson. He was kind of my favorite character because cute animals. Besides just being cute, Jefferson actually serves as this sort of symbolic element of the story with his cagedness, the sort of birdcage symbolism of being stuck with all of these people who mean well but are not really helping you. I'm not going to tell you which character that pertains to, but it kind of pertains to everybody in this movie because there's just a lot going on, and I thought that poor Jefferson's plight kind of worked as a good symbol for that. As for the humans, the actors are all good at being really subtle. At first, I was kind of like, they don't really have that many defining characteristics to them, but as you get more into the story, you see more and more of the layers to these characters. They're not the most deep characters you've seen, because this movie runs about an hour and 40 minutes. This isn't like a Lord of the Rings style epic where you get into every character's backstory, but there are these layers to these characters that I really like. Again, the mom was very crafty. She's taken in foster kids before. She's got the past issues with her husband. Sarah, the girl she takes in, is a bit of an enigma from most of the movie, but she's got a lot of issues that come to the forefront as the movie goes on, and most of them do relate to the traumatic loss of her mother and her father in that accident. We've got the brother who is trying to carry on a relationship with a girl that he's met while also trying to take care of this family. He's trying to balance those things, and he's not doing such a great job of it. Lenore just wants out of this god-awful situation and to be a normal girl and to do normal teenage girl things, hang out with her friends, but she also just has to really, really commit to her grades and her academic stuff, because if she does not, that's kind of her way out from this situation because of the financial stuff and just the crappiness of the overall situation her family is in. And the uncle kind of seems to be harboring this secret crush towards his late brother's wife, which they play with some in the movie, and it's kind of creepy but also sad. He has all of these cars and stuff around, and he works on projects, as does the brother, and his main thing is he's got this car that he's been working on, and it's super pristine and perfect, and no one's allowed to touch that, and frankly, no one's allowed to really touch anything. He's very, very particular about that. At first, I thought that the actress who was playing Sarah kind of felt unpolished, but that was really just sort of the the childishness of the character. As the movie develops, you see more and more sides of her character and her sadness and her anger and all of these different emotions that she can put forth in really subtle ways and in really, really dramatic ways. She was fantastic. She was a standout part of the movie, but everybody did a great job. My one big problem with the characters was, for a little while, I kind of had trouble telling Uncle Daryl and the brother apart because they're both guys of a slightly similar height who have similar haircuts, and they both work on stuff in the junkyard, and they have similarly snarky personalities, but they've got defining traits that are very, very different from each other, so I worked it out eventually, but at the beginning of the movie, I was struggling to tell them apart a little bit. The story is overall really, really bleak, but it has these sort of fun, witty moments in it. There is a moment in the beginning of the film where Lenore is talking with one of her friends on the phone, and she's going, yeah, my uncle has like two Porsches and a convertible. This is like our own little desert hideaway, you might even say, as she's looking at these once probably very nice cars in this big junk heap, and it's both very sort of funny and witty, but also very, very sad. Again, there is definitely trauma in the past of these characters. You've got the mom and that whole family that she's taking care of. Everybody in this house has had to deal with the death of her husband, who is also the father of these kids, and the brother of this guy, Daryl. Sarah is there having to deal with the loss of both of her parents, so we do get some sort of flashbacks and mentally trying moments with all of these characters, sort of remembering those things, but they don't ram it down your throat with like nightmare sequences. It doesn't linger on that. It plays it really subtly. It just sort of gives you enough to feel the pain of these characters, and it's done really tastefully, I'd say. As I was saying before with the setting, it really, really enhances the story in terms of symbolism. You've got the junkyard and the uncle's work on cars, and the way that really speaks to the trauma that the whole family is going through and that Sarah is going through because of the whole car accident deal. They're literally living surrounded by a pile of wrecked cars, and he's sort of talking about accidents during dinner, and it's just like, this is not helping anything. Why did you think it was a good idea to move here? But also, it's perfect. The fact that there are these wolves on the land that will not leave, not only do they add another dangerous element to the story that actually does play into the story, but they sort of serve to symbolize the human wolf in sheep wolf in sheep's clothing, or wolves in sheep's clothing, that may or may not be messing with the family and making the situation even worse. It's not just their sort of past trauma and all of the sort of nasty stuff happening within the family that's screwing them over. It's kind of society, which is a big thing with them. You see them figuring out how to get money and trying to get a new job or to rent an apartment, and it's never really working. There's a scene where the mom tries to rent an apartment and the guy's just like, oh, you have two kids? Yeah, I'm sorry. We have some restrictions. You can have a cat, though. I'll let you come if you just bring a cat. And again, it's really funny, but also really sad. It uses these pop culture references. I can't bring up all of them. There aren't that many, but this movie plays with a lot of elements, and so many that I can't dive into all of them. Just watch the movie. There's a moment where the brother wants to go and have sex with his girlfriend, but right after he's made plans with that, he actually has to babysit Sarah. So what he ends up doing is just turning on the TV to whatever channel it's on and being like, you sit here and watch the show. We're gonna be in bed if anybody asks, so bye. They leave, and it shows just sort of the TV glowing on her face, and then it turns to her perspective, and she's watching Night of the Living Dead, because of course she is. It's public domain, it's iconic, and it's exactly what you don't want to be showing this little girl who's experienced this horrible trauma. So, yeah. And overall, the story of this movie is not on the horror side. It's more of a thriller, but it's got some very horrific moments. There is death in this movie. It is kind of similar in a way to movies like The Lodge or even The Cleaning Lady. It's not as flat out disturbing and disgusting in the way The Cleaning Lady is, but it sort of deals with tension and people in a similar way. There aren't any, like, jump scares in the movie, and there aren't really any slasher gore type moments. There are deaths in the movie, and they are bloody. The blood looks decent. It's understated, and they kind of hide some of it with the lighting, so it's left more to your imagination. But this movie is very brutal in its own way. It's not, I wouldn't, like, say, you know, trigger warnings for gore or graphic sexual stuff, because there's none of that in this movie, but it deals with a lot of really heavy themes. Trauma, loss, suicide, all of the things. And there's also animal death, and there's much sadness there. I'm not going to tell you what animal dies, but you probably know. I'm not over it. I'm not over it at all. I'm still very upset about that. This movie is fantastic. It's a really, really well-crafted thriller. It's not an enjoyable film, but it's very, very well-crafted. I definitely recommend this movie to anyone who wants to watch a bleak, subtle, atmospheric, but still brutal and violent and dark film. That is my spoiler-free review of Hurts. Here are the spoilers. So, as you might have guessed from my bit of anger there at the very end, Jefferson dies, his neck gets broken, and I'm not over it. I'm not over it at all. We never see it happen, but we see dead Jefferson afterwards, and I'm not over it. I'm still very, very sad for Jefferson. And the ultimate reveal at the end of this film is that Sarah is, in fact, the half-sister of Lenore, and the father that Lenore lost and the father that Sarah lost are in fact one and the same, because he kind of had two wives, and he was going back and forth between these two families he had. He was gone with the one family that the Coltranes that we've been following all this time, and his other wife is not pleased by that and takes it out on Sarah, so she has all this history of abuse. And the way that both of them died was not just in this car wreck. The other wife very deliberately ran into her husband, killing him, killing herself in the process, and all of this time Sarah was in the backseat. And this has kind of scarred her forever. For whatever reason, he thought it was a good idea to have Sarah be adopted by her other family. Lenore says later on, "Oh great, my dad has just sent an armed missile into our home." Sarah, because of all of this horrific stuff she's experienced, has been turning all of the family members against each other and killing them indirectly. She never just stabs somebody with a knife. She makes someone fall into a pit where they get impaled, or this metal sculpture that the brother was building falls on him. She pushes Uncle Daryl over the edge and he commits suicide. She almost kills the mom by messing with her medication. I kind of saw the whole creepy kid messes with family thing coming, but it's done in a really, really well-crafted way, and you see her sympathetic side and her anger towards the family, and both her childish act and her intelligence and her malice and her sadness. It's all just really, really good. I'm not going to tell you exactly how the movie ends, but it was intense. Once again, this movie is just a perfect example of a really well-made thriller. It's not a fun movie. It's not the most distinctive reinventing the wheel type movie I've ever seen, but it's just a really good thriller. That is my review for Hurt. Thank you for watching my video, and hopefully I will see you in another one. Bye.